Thank you, Chris. Welcome to the South Deerfield Town Hall meeting of the Deerfield Select Board on September 7th, 2015 at 6:40 p.m. First item on the agenda is our new superintendent, Lynn Carey. Thank you so much for coming up.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Come on up. I'm sorry. We're a little discombobulated. We've had meetings since 4 o'clock this afternoon, yeah. And we're set up voting.
Sure.
So great.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
I'm Carolyn, and I know you know Trevor. This is Kip Camosa.
Hi, dear.
Hi. So how are you settling in?
It's been a wonderful summer. I've been meeting all kinds of folks. They come in. We've made a lot of interviews. I've had a lot of interviews. So I have an entry plan that has me asking, you know, specific questions. What makes Frontier and Union 38 such a great place? What are some of the challenges we have? What would you like to see from me as a superintendent? And so I'm putting all that information together, and I'll have a report for the joint committee in October, so that all that information will be there.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah, and that way it helped me a lot to get the feel of the district, but it didn't take long. People were so kind and helped me acclimate myself to the district that I was able to really kind of get the sense that people are very happy here. They stay in this district for a long time. Mm-hmm. Our schools are absolutely beautiful facilities, and the Deerfield roof is tremendous. It's amazing. It's quite the cherry on top of the Deerfield cake. It's a beautiful school, but inside they did a lot of work too. And I was thrilled. All our facilities, though, the district is, you know, just wonderful. And Frontier Regional it's just a wonderful place to be. I'm very happy to be here.
Well, we're really excited to have you. And
thank
we really
you.
Appreciate it. One thing that came up, I'm sorry, I was on vacation. And so I just got back in time to go to a Homeland Security meeting yesterday. So I haven't had a chance to call you to give you any heads up. But one thing that has come up that... Mm-hmm. I'm really interested in supporting is child unification drill.
Uh-huh.
We, over the years, Mark Gilmore is our emergency manager, and over the years, we've always been really concerned if there was like a train derailment, mm-hmm. and we'd have to evacuate the kids at the elementary school and at Frontier, and, you know, it would just be gridlock. With social media and everything gets out so fast that you would have a hard time getting responders in and all kinds of stuff. And so right now Homeland Security is working on children in disasters reunification program. And it looks like the state police have a fairly really good plan.
Mm-hmm.
So we're trying to adapt it. And what we'd like to do is fund a drill sometime, and I was just thinking maybe at the end of the year or the following year, you know, because I know it's so hard to schedule stuff, you know, and this would be a real drill where we would, you know, evacuate children, have a secondary meeting place, and just over the years, I have no issues. I'm on the regional emergency planning committee that Mark also participates in. So I don't really have any issues with our first responders handling hazmat, mm-hmm. the hazmat part of it.
Right.
But it's mm-hmm. all the other agencies and the school's administration and staff and the children and how parents would react and stuff. So to me, it would be really wonderful if we could get Homeland Security to fund the drill for us to practice. And so I was hoping at some point, you know, to talk to you about it. And, you know, I'm not talking about right now or anything. Right. And it would be, and I know most of you are probably scheduled up for this year, but at some point.
Well, Trevor can tell mm-hmm. you that yesterday, Trevor was there at our opening ceremony,
yes.
our opening welcome back for the staff and the administration, and so I was able to give a welcome speech, and then we had the principals welcome the new folks, and then 20-year recognition awards.
Yeah.
And then I had actually invited the police chiefs of the four towns and the state troopers to come in, because my initiative for this year is actually our safety plans.
Mm. Oh,
and
wonderful.
So we had talked, we had one long meeting. I had all of the folks here, but we have four meetings planned with the four, it's called Four Town Emergency Services, mm-hmm. or something. But this is in the works. This is something we really need to do. Until you see it and go through it, mm-hmm. you really, you know, once you do it, and once we all go through it, there'll be enough people left for 5-10 years that have actually seen the process, so that it would be orderly. And you're right, the district I came from, a student actually was able to bring a rifle and two pieces into school, and he actually shot here. He just damaged his face. He didn't actually. But it was, the helicopters were over, you know, all the news agencies, the televisions, but they were able to, after a point, have that orderly reunification where the parents were actually coming in another door.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, they didn't remove the you know, but they actually forgot. They called a lockdown or a shelter mm-hmm. in place, and then they forgot to, he did it in the lunchroom, and then they forgot all the people upstairs, all the kids in the classrooms, and they were just sitting there
waiting.
They were actually, they called lockdown, and they were sitting in lockdown mode as opposed to shelter in place. So right. that we learn a lot from these things, but yeah. I'm very interested in it. And the state troopers gave wonderful PowerPoint on what we've learned from these other places where you think it'll never happen here. They all thought that too, so mm-hmm. being prepared is so important.
Well, we did. Homeland Security sponsored, we had the speakers from Newtown come, mm-hmm. and we had it last spring, and that was really tremendous. Mm-hmm. It impacted me quite a bit. And but I have always been concerned about like a train derailment or some mm-hmm. kind of
sure
emergency
thing.
And then we would be gridlocked and we wouldn't be able to move to a secondary meeting site and have a mm-hmm. way to orderly
right.
because everything is so tight down here and there's
how
so many
quickly,
kids.
How quickly could we get the buses in
mm-hmm.
to take the children from a
right.
place? And if it is, say, something in the air, how are we going to...
Right.
Right.
And how can the parents...
Right. So like I said, I'm not so worried about our first responders handling the hazmat,
right.
but I am concerned about the other things. And we, you know, if there was a way for Homeland Security to fund, you know, a full-scale drill, it would be wonderful. So
right.
we'll continue offline on that.
Yeah.
And so thank you for being at least interested in
and
be open to it, because, you know, a lot of times there are people, you know, aren't. And,
the safety of our students
yeah.
is
number one
is right. That's
yeah, that's really exciting.
I'm
and
thrilled that we're both thinking the same way too.
Well,
because that was
both
that's my
John
initiative.
Kachorik, our police chief, and I are. Yeah. He represents the police, and I represent the municipal reps on the Homeland Security. So we should be able to get funding.
Right. Well, thank you.
We'll advocate for that. So that's wonderful. So
thank
we'll,
you very
we'll
much.
Continue on that. And that way it won't be a burden to the district, but we could actually get it. And then we can do the after action, have a full after action report that would give us recommendations that we could actually follow through on. So mm-hmm. that would be huge,
I think. That debriefing is what will make
mm-hmm.
us stronger and actually help us have the confidence that we know we will be able to handle it. And
right.
it, just having that confidence of going through it and knowing what it looks like, what it feels like,
right.
that just takes away a lot of anxiety.
Sure.
Right. Well, that would be wonderful, because we've been talking about that for years, so that would be huge. And then, there's always the budget, and there's never enough money. And so I'm really excited from what I've understood from Trevor, your totally understanding of that, and that we can work together and have a handle on that, and that's huge. So I really appreciate that again.
Thank you. And thank you for your work this summer on the roof.
Mm. Well, it was Kip. Thank God he was there, because I just was there to support whatever he and Dick wanted to do. But it was a real hassle, I have to tell you. And thank God we did have Kip and Dick working on this.
We talk a little bit about, my husband and I, why don't you build a house? And we say, by the time we're done building a house, we'll be divorced. So what's the, it's tough. These building things are hard. But it did come out beautifully, and I'm very proud of it.
Well, a lot of it had to do with that we had the triple laminate shingles.
Yeah.
And that was a struggle to get that done. Yeah. But
it looks very attractive.
So thank you.
Sure,
while we're on that topic of safety, I was at the school quite a bit this summer, and one of the things that I noticed is when the train goes by at 70 plus miles an hour, there's a row of swings and some sort of a squash ball court or something, 30 feet from those train tracks. And I always thought that if there was a derailment, if there are any children there, they'd wipe them all out.
Yeah.
Could it be possible that that playground be moved to the other side of the school? I know there's limited space there, but I mean, that's less than from here to the corner of this room.
Mm-hmm.
And there's swings and everything right there, and the train goes by at 70 miles an hour. It's something that we could do now. And if there ever was a derailment, dealing with the chemicals or fire or whatever, that's one thing. But if there were kids there,
exactly. It'd
be pretty bad.
It's definitely something I'll bring to Bob's attention and see what it would take to actually move that equipment.
Yeah.
On Bob Lesko. I'm sorry when I say Bob.
And the Gaga Ball Court, which is what that is, was all that was installed way before that train was ever going that speed. And we've all had that concern so it's a great idea to see what we can do to kind of get the space on the other side.
Definitely look into it.
And now that we've done a new playground and all. And
I do know that the Deerfield PTA is looking to do a little bit more work on the playground this fall.
They are.
And so maybe coordination with the PTA might be in order.
Yep.
That might be one of the things they could do, because they're planning a community build again.
Yep.
And maybe that's one of the tasks that could be taken on at the same time. Mm-hmm.
That's great information, because I'm going to the PTA meeting, I think it's next week.
Yes.
So.
Yep. They're going to be talking about that.
Yeah.
So maybe that'd be the time to integrate it into the agenda.
Yeah. And I'll talk to Bob Lesko before I go.
Absolutely.
So I'll have some information.
Yeah, maybe that we could figure out how to do something.
Yeah.
But anyway, like I said, the budget is always nasty.
That'll be a different story.
But, I'm actually really excited, because we did set some money aside, which never panned out to the person that we were going to hire. We didn't hire to look at long-range planning. So I think that you're new here, and we have the money set aside. All four towns voted some kind of long-range planning funding. I think it was five or $6,000 each, right?
The town of Deerfield's share was only about $4,000. Okay. I think it was a total of about $24,000 all told, or $28,000.
Yeah, but it was never spent.
It was never spent.
So, because my big thing is, we argue all the time about, the budget, but it's just sustaining something that's not sustainable. So I got really excited on the long-range planning committee, because we were talking about interesting things and changing the facilities around and stuff like that, and doing specialized science classes and specialized focus magnet kind of school kind of things. I mean, there was a whole bunch of long list of suggestions, but it was really exciting, because what we're doing now is not sustainable in our budget. And so instead of fighting about trying, what piece of pie you get when the pie isn't getting any bigger, let's change, what are we asking for, and keep investing in our kids and new programs and things that are exciting, instead of just, trying to maintain what we can't maintain.
I'm all about I'm all about keeping our kids here. Mm-hmm. Frontier is just a fabulous school. It's a wonderful school. It's an excellent school. And I would put our graduates and where they go up against any other charter school where those graduates go. We have what it takes, and we have the facility, we have the teachers, we have the talent here. And so one of the big things that I think about constantly, and we talk about, and it was one of my interview questions, how do we meet the needs of the all the different kids that we have, meet the needs here to keep them here with us And that's something that, well, we're going to be voting pretty soon, and hopefully they'll put a cap on.
Yes.
So we're trying, you know, really hard to.
Well, and so, you know, we have that money set aside, and it would be really neat for you to, you know, see what you could do with it and put that committee back together and
sure
figure out how to spend that money, because nobody, I mean, it's I think everyone hung on to it. I don't I know we did.
Yeah, we didn't actually expend it. It wasn't billed
right
out,
and we didn't, we on purpose, you know, held it over. So I think a lot, most of the other towns did too. So and it wasn't a huge appropriation, but it was enough to fund somebody to do something with you, so it would be exciting.
Yeah.
That sounds exciting. There's a lot of talk about STEM and focusing on the engineering piece of STEM.
Great.
And that's really, I think that would be exciting to some of our students.
Yeah.
And one of the things that excited me was, you know, trying to engage kids in their communities and you know, what civic kind of things. I mean, the MCAS really squished a lot of the, you know, involvement with town, the town government and town activities. And so, I really would like to see that, you know.
One of the things that we have in the works with our out-of-school time program, they're going to start doing some landscaping or weeding or taking care of the grounds around the building itself.
Oh,
and I said, you know, we'll bring him to the board, we'll recognize him there, bring him to the selectmen, recognize the students there, the fifth and sixth grade students. But there are other things. We're having a musical this year in the high school we're thrilled about. The elementary schools are all having strings, which is exciting. I mean,
great program.
You don't hear about that too often. So.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things that make us special and make us leg up from the average.
I'm really excited about working with you, so thank you.
Thank you
for taking the time to come tonight.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
I'm glad you had a good first day.
Yes, it was a wonderful day. Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Yep.
Have a lovely evening.
Yep.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Ben, sorry to make you wait. I appreciate the apples.
Yeah.
You know, I tried those Sansa apples. Those were really good, actually.
Well, great. No, I'm glad to hear. And I'm glad to hear with the superintendent. My son just started preschool today with your granddaughter.
Exciting.
So it's exciting time. More kids in Deerfield schools.
Yay.
So I'm here for the get permission from the board to hold our second annual cider run. This is a benefit to a nonprofit benefit to of CESA, which is based right here in South Deerfield, supporting farms in the Pioneer Valley. Last year we had a very successful event. We had over 150 runners, and it's the upper lower road course on a Sunday morning. We didn't shut down traffic. We had at least one lane open, and we had Deerfield Police was there assisting with traffic flow. We do cut into Greenfield briefly, and I'm in the process. If this board approves, I'm going to Greenfield for approval there. And Chief Pachurik was supportive last year and this year, and he actually ran it as well.
He and his wife both.
Yes, they both ran it. And it was a good event. Brings people out to the farm. It's mostly local people, but it does bring some outside people in to see the area as well. It's a pretty straightforward run.
Do either one of you have any questions?
No, I think it's a great idea.
Yeah.
Great.
Love it.
Then I make a motion that we approve and support the 12K Cider Run on November 13th at 9:30 a.m.
I'll second.
Is there any further discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Hey.
Sounds good.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it.
Sure.
We'll put this on the website.
Sure. Yeah. And enjoy the apples.
What's the date again?
The date is November 13th, 9:30 a.m.
November 15th.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Thank
Have
you.
A good night.
Thanks.
Thank you, Ben.
Yep.
And Emerson was adorable. Okay, the next item on the agenda is our minutes of August 24th.
Yes.
Do we have those?
They're in your packet.
Okay.
Packet.
Would somebody, did you guys have a chance to review them?
I did quickly.
Where do you put them?
Are you all set?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to abstain because
I make a motion that we accept the minutes as written.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And I'll abstain.
Okay.
Okay. Warrant. We have the warrant here.
I signed it.
Okay.
I'm done. I did sign.
Oh, okay.
Yep, I'm all set.
I'm sorry. I've been in meetings.
You need to vote to sign it.
Yes.
Yeah. The next item is the truck chassis award. I know Chuck was able to squeeze out additional savings, and or trade-in was better, and the savings was, there was a additional price reduction. So thank you, Chuck. Okay. And Mark Hutt is guaranteeing the delivery for October 14th, which meets our requirement for snow season.
Correct.
So I make a motion that we approve the bid as received.
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
Well, I just want to make sure you folks know that this is just the beginning of this process. I'm still opposed to purchasing this vehicle because we're going to have Kevin back in here looking for a very expensive body and other components to go with the truck. And I just don't feel that he's replacing the truck with what he has. It's a huge upgrade and a huge expense that I don't really think we need. That's just my opinion.
Okay, well, we did vote it at town meeting and the Capital Improvement Committee did approve it.
Well, you know, and that's one of the things we just talked about.
I know.
It's one thing to request to replace something and then go from a $40,000 vehicle to an $80,000 vehicle. It's not really replacing it.
But I thought the bid was for $47,524, less the trade-in $12,000, so the net price to the town was $35,524.
Correct. This is for just the chassis. This is for the cab, the engine, the transmission, the wheels, the frame.
Right.
Onto that will go a hydraulic lifted dump bed. On the dump bed will go a sander, and on the front of the truck will go a plow. Those are being purchased through other vendors that are state vendors under state contract. And the reason this was done is because the price for the truck chassis, and then adding on the other things, was lower than purchasing a truck completely outfitted.
Right.
It also enables the town to get this vehicle in time for the winter season, which would not have been possible if they tried to order the truck completely configured. That's a 4 to 6 month, my understanding. We would not get the truck until sometime in February or March, even if we had ordered it off state contract back in July or August. There's a 7 or 8 month wait.
Do we know what the cost of the other items are yet?
I know that we're limited by the appropriation, and the appropriation, I think, was $72,000 or $80,000, around there. So I assume the other items are about between $30,000 and $35,000.
Yeah, well, I know Kevin is very, and Chuck are very careful to make sure they come in under the appropriation, or close to the appropriation. Well, then, all those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. 2-1. It's okay. I mean, sorry. Don't feel bad. I understand where you're coming from. Next item on the agenda is requests for comments on the cell partnership with doing business as Verizon Wireless.
This you will not find in your packet, but it's a single loose sheet that was added afterward.
Okay.
And I apologize for that.
Okay.
This is for a replacement of the tower that is located on the grounds of the South Deerfield Fire Department.
Mm-hmm.
They're replacing it with a tower that's slightly taller and that is of a slightly different construction, being a monopole instead of a lattice-type tower. And the ZBA is looking for any comments you might have.
Kip, do you have anything that you wanted to say on this?
The only thing is the tower that was there, a for private cell tower, or was it for the fire department to use?
It is a private cell tower. Okay. I believe the fire department has rights to place, and if there's anybody here who can correct me on this, My understanding is they have the right to place a transceiver or an antenna on it. It is,
and we have it.
The tower itself is being built by a private company, and then will be given to the fire department whole. That was one of the requirements. And that vendor will then be leasing the land underneath the tower and given the right to lease tower space. That's my understanding from the conversation I had with Kevin. So there's that.
Was there originally a variance of some sort to put that tower there?
There was. It's either a variance or it had an overlay zone. As a matter of fact, I think it's actually in the overlay zone for cellular communications.
Well, the reason I ask is because I looked and all the cell tower districts are in the planned industrial district, and that's not. So, but I don't know how long that had been there, and that's why I asked the question if the tower was specific for the fire, you know, emergency thing, or if it was a public
commercial. Yeah, okay. But pretty sure the overlay zone includes that area as well as the other area on the top of the ridge in Old Deerfield. Where the other cell tower is. Thank you, on Pecumtuck Ridge. So
the tower that's on the fire department property now was in the same configuration it's going to be now. It saved the town district, South Deerfield district, from having to put up the tower. It was put up at no cost to the townspeople.
Right.
So they're getting the service for nothing, and they're getting to lease the property and cuts down the cost of the town.
Yep.
Okay.
And this new one's just going to be taller and then have a different configuration?
It'll look different. It'll be 20 feet taller.
Normal pole.
But I don't have that knowledge. It's just
what you've seen. Yep. Okie dokie.
Okay. When do they want the comments by, Doug? When is the date?
As soon as possible. The public hearing is coming up in a couple of weeks.
Okay.
And the sooner they get the comments, the better.
All right. If you have anything more.
Mark.
You might want to check with Mr. Scarborough to see if he wants to put a repeater for the garage.
It's not a bad option to consider.
Oh, yeah.
Give them great coverage for helping out the board.
Mark, that's a really good idea.
I don't know. And that's not a suggestion on skills and knowledge. It's just a basic ask question.
Yeah.
I don't know if it would be beneficial to him or not. But
yeah.
Just check.
Use the same pole as there and put a combiner.
Yep.
And use because it's so limited to use. You can
double up on it
and get good coverage.
Would that
be
used for
side cavity?
It's
the same frequency as the
fire.
It's in the same bandwidth.
Right.
Could be.
We're switching over, and I think this week, and I actually I didn't have a chance to talk to John, but September 1st, we're switching over to the new interoperability system that the state police is supporting.
Okay.
So I think EMS,
everything
is on the same band, and they'll be able, when they pull it up, they will see everything. You know, has fire been there? Has EMS been
there?
Right. And then everybody's supposed to be doing it. I talked to John when I came home, but I didn't actually. I forgot about that. It was supposed to be September 1st. So It should be, yeah. So it, we'll, we're, well, we will have. Pardon me?
They operate off the same dispatch.
Yeah.
All of the emergency services operate off of the.
Yeah, and under this.
Yeah.
Right, and this whole new operability thing is that everybody can see everything, everybody. So, we're one of the pilot starts first towns that are getting, you know, on board. Yeah. So you haven't heard anything, have you? Okay. I'll have to follow up on John. It's supposed to be. Well, the dispatch Shelburne Control went on last month with no problems, and everything. There was one issue. It's direct and backed up to Framingham, and that there was one small issue that was addressed, and it went through the whole month without any problems. So, three towns are being set up, and we're one of them for September 1st, and then at the end of the month. As long as there's no issues, everybody is using the system correctly, then everything has been fixed that popped up, then there'll be another four or five towns put on. And then by the end of December, all the towns should be on board.
Is there a full proposal on where it's going to be after 5 years?
Well, when we met with the state police and Kurt Woods, who's the executive secretary, he promised to pay, well, we're having big savings because he's paying the maintenance fee up for this year and paying 50% after. So instead of paying $10,000, about $10,000, the cost to the town of Deerfield, it's like $3,000 or $4,000. So there's huge savings. And if John is watching this, he's probably saying you're getting the numbers all mixed up. But it's something like that. It's substantial savings to us and every town. And for the first 3 years, it's no cost, I think, maybe something like that. And then the 2 years, it's like 50%. So no discussion after 5 years. And the reason why is, you know, they can't go beyond a certain number of years. And we're using, you know, everybody pays into the 911 fund, and some of it is being funded by 911, and you can't use grant money beyond a certain number of years. So it will not hopefully cost us very much in the long run, but we're certainly have huge savings right now. And it, pardon me? You know, I have notes everywhere, but they're at home. I don't have them in front of me. And
are they replacing all the radios and the apparatus?
It will be very good, but the best thing to do is to call John. And the most exciting thing is you will have all the information of how many EMS or fire visits have been to that address, all the police visits to the address. So everyone, no matter who you are, will, when you go to show up, everything will be, all the information on the history of that address will pop up. You're not going in blind. We've, you know, had so many incidents with, you know, the meth labs and stuff all over the country. So not necessarily in our town, but, you know, everywhere. So it's a huge have everybody, building inspector, everybody, all information will be there. And it's very exciting. And it's brand new technology, and it brings everybody on board. And if a car is stopped in East County and it ends up being stopped here, or then on the way out in West County, it will pop up on the, so that by the time you get to the third stop, it'll say, you know, this guy shouldn't be driving or whatever. You know, it's not, nobody's acting in isolation anymore. All the information across the county will be shared. And it's access to everybody. So it's very good.
It's also going to provide early warning for fire departments.
Yes.
If there's a fire, they'll know exactly where and when, and they don't have to wait out for a second alarm or third alarm. They'll know exactly what's going on. If they hear a location that they know could be significant, they can be ready to roll, and that's going to improve response time.
Yeah, all the information about that site, you know, hazardous materials, yep. All that stuff will be going to pop up on the screen. So It's really exciting. It was a lot of work. Again, just like in the roof, I went along. I didn't do that much. It was John Pachorek that did most of the real work, legwork. But we had tons of meetings, and EMS was on board. Fire was on board. There was a lot of discussion with fire. And the fire people stepped up to the plate and came to a lot of meetings so that we were able to pull this all together. It's a huge benefit, huge benefit.
It's great.
And it saves us money, so it's pretty exciting. No. It's just Shelburne Control.
Okay. It's enough.
Okay. Anyway. Next item on the agenda is 72 Mill Village Road update from Zoning Enforcement Officer. We have a letter from Dick saying that there's been considerable progress made in this last month. Most commercial equipment, i.e. dumpsters, trailer, man lift, and other construction equipment has been removed from the site. While there may be some miscellaneous items remaining, they are not a public health threat or a major zoning violation. So it is in his recommendation that its matter be tabled for additional 30 days for monitoring of future project progress. And I am very supportive of that, his recommendation. Is there any discussion or on that?
No, I just, love to see it continue. And I mean, I've just made great strides and get it cleaned up. So that's great.
Appreciate Matthew working on this. Thank you, Mark. Next item on the agenda is the Weston and Sampson Transfer Station Well Monitoring Contract. This is a renewal of our standard contract. And from my understand from Kevin, he has no problem with the renewal. And we've met all the requirements for DEP, and they've submitted everything that was necessary. Did you, either one of you had any questions? Were you able to look at this, Captain? Were you able to look at the contract and to see if you had any questions?
No, I did not.
Okay. We've had this for several years.
Do we know the cost?
Usually the test well monitoring and the maintenance and the reporting is usually between $60,000 and $70,000 per year. My understanding, and it depends a lot on the number of wells that are tested and the various reports that need to be filed.
And if they hit, it's for,
not to exceed 46,000.
46,000. Okay. That's what we appropriated, but it depends if any of the tests come back, then they do.
What's some issue?
Issues, they do additional tests. So the additional tests are added in.
Okay. Yeah, additional service times basis on that.
It gives you a little buffer.
And
if nothing hits, like this is extremely dry year,
right?
So there's not going to be any flow. So probably that money won't be expended based on our current weather. So I'll entertain a motion for approval.
Make a motion to approve the Weston and Sampson well monitoring contract.
I'll second.
Is there any further discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
There are
two copies in this folder for your signature. Turn to the page that has the corner folded down.
Yep.
And it requires all three signatures.
All right. So we'll do that. Next item on the agenda is a contract approval for Maya Member Services. Kevin recommended this renewal. And Doug, I just wanted to make sure that we were participating in as many programs as possible.
Oh, absolutely, we are. The training that's been completed by members of the Highway Department, as well as some members of the administrative staff, have actually resulted in the savings to the town of about $1,600 this year and about that same amount last year.
Okay.
Those savings go directly to reducing our overall insurance costs. And these trainings are things like OSHA safety trainings, even trainings in hydraulics and the other material, the other tasks and functions of the Highway Department. In addition, Kevin is pursuing an OSHA trainer training, which when complete would enable him to actually conduct OSHA training here in town, not only for our own employees, but also for other town employees as well, from other municipalities. All of this, again, results in a safer workplace and a lower bill for us.
Okay.
So I definitely recommend endorsement of this contract.
Oh, it's Massachusetts Insurance Institute.
Association.
It's a state version of when all the insurance companies were pulling out. It's a cooperative that towns got together. Yeah.
It's group insurance. Yeah.
They reinsure. They pass on the insurance for they reassure it, but they do offer some discounts.
He's been made aware of them. One of the most recent things that came across the email this past week was an opportunity for the town to host what's called an ALICE training, which is basically a high alert situation at a public facility or a school. And we put our name in to become a secondary training site for that. It's something which won't cost the town anything. It would provide those training services to all of Western Mass municipalities and especially our schools, provide training for administration, for staff, for faculty, as well as for local law enforcement. And so hopefully we can actually be selected, and it'll be, again, a little bit more money that we don't have to pay to our insurance bill.
We didn't need that.
Oh.
That was in there.
That's the expectation, yes. Dr. Carey was made aware of that opportunity, and as was Darius Modesto, the principal of Frontier Regional, and Janine Heil, principal of Deerfield Elementary.
I guess I got stuck in there.
So if we are selected, there will definitely be active promotion of the training opportunity for our local schools, and of course, to all local law enforcement.
You know what, Kathy? It's so funny. Going through all the literature here, it's not Maya is not spelled out anywhere.
Yeah, it's not. It's
it's Massachusetts Insurance.
It's like Interlocal Insurance
Association
or something
yeah.
like that.
I just have a real problem with all of
them. I know.
Acronyms.
I know.
We live and die by acronyms.
I know. No.
Yeah.
No, there's a ton of them. They're everywhere. The federal government has a million and a half. I know. Yeah. Well, it's really funny. I can't remember what the
Massachusetts Interlocal Insurance Association.
Okay.
A nonprofit organization.
Well, we got the interlocal was the one that was stumping me.
Yep.
No. Well, I knew Massachusetts, but all right.
I make a motion to continue. Support and commitment of the MIIA programs.
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Doug, for that information. Next item on the agenda is the Captain Lathrop Lift Station Engineering Study that Weston Sampson is proposing. Kip, is this recommended by the sewer committee?
No. But it's not recommended, but it's not recommended.
Oh, so you're not making
you
a recommendation or
no,
what do you
what I said to Kevin is before we I mean it's $4,000. I mean my initial thought was, you know, if it could have been done, it would have been done. And I spoke about this at our last meeting. I told Trevor that I reached out to several of our senior residents that would have known about this, and there were specific reasons why it wasn't done. Mr. Decker made me aware of partial land easements to go behind a couple of those homes on North Main Street, but it stops abruptly at, I forget the person's name, farm. But what I offered Kevin is if they wanted to open a couple of the manholes, I could shoot an elevation grade and tell them what the difference is, but I don't really see that. I think if we spend the $4,000, we're going to get an answer that says Well, it can't be done for this reason, but if you wanted to take land by eminent domain or purchase land or something like that, then we probably could go down along the brook and connect over there. And I don't know what expense or what the problems are there. I think that this study would only be the beginning of a very expensive project. And I would like to, you know, hold off on spending the money until the sewer study committee has some idea of what direction we're going to go in as far as, you know, infrastructure and things like that, mm-hmm. even though that is not right at the forefront of our discussion.
I think that makes sense that you just hold off on this. There isn't any date that we committed to, did we?
We haven't committed to anything. Okay. This is just a proposal. It has been discussed. And it was probably prompted by the recent failure of, again, of one of the pumps at the Captain Lathrop lift station. Yeah.
Down to one pump?
No, there are two pumps operating, but we were operating for about a week with a single pump. That was a week that Kevin did not get any sleep. Because if that one pump failed, the workaround would have been very complex, involving hoses over the ground and so on and so forth. The intention behind the study was to try to find a way to eliminate that lift station entirely. That being said, I certainly understand the need to look at this one potential project in the greater picture of the sewer plan, and it's hard to argue with that. I would certainly not. Who would fault the board for wanting to put it aside and to let the sewer study committee have its hands?
Yeah, I think that's what I'd like to do. Is that all right with you, Trevor?
One thing you want to keep in mind is the fact that that lift study, that lift station is fairly deep, and basically going down there is not the safest for people to do.
Oh, I know.
It's not what you
it's nasty.
Station in today's standards.
Okay.
It's 30-year-old technology.
It's very old, and it was done on a shoestring because, as Kip has said, they ran out of money, and they put this thing in, helter-skelter, figuring that they would try to get more money and modify it. And as time went by, money never was appropriated, and it gets a lot more expensive. Back then, it was cheap because we didn't have the
regulations
that you have for digging trenches and stuff like that. It's really, I believe the study is to figure out how to make it a safer ordeal. That's what you're saying, it's failed over the last 10 to 15 years, multiple times, and when you're on a single pump, it's
scary.
And when you try to pull out, it's not good. It's not a job I'm on there.
Is this included in your is this part in your sewer
study? It's going to be part of, you know, all of the infrastructure, all of the pipes in town. But we've been working more on a rate study for right now, but we're going to go from that.
I just wasn't sure if this was included.
It will, yeah, it will be. But I'll reach out to Kevin, too, and talk with him more about it. You know, there's a lot of details that I don't really know.
Same here.
But like I said, I did speak to a half a dozen residents in town that, you know, plumbers and people have been involved with the sewer and stuff like that. And I actually spoke with one of the plumbers who did the house right on the corner and, you know, got his feedback as to why things happened back then and stuff like that. So,
okay. Well, I don't think there'd be any problems tabling it. So let's table. Is that okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's just table it.
Okay.
I think it's better to have the comprehensive overview.
Okay.
Next item on the agenda is the CDBG, 1-year action plan changes,
right,
which is the community block grant, Department of Housing and Community Development block grant program, Kathy. I do have that one.
You have some information in your packet in regard to this. The acronym TLDR means too long, didn't read. And so I summarized it for you, and I'm happy to read this out. There are proposed changes to the Community Development Block Grant Program that mean that Deerfield will have to jump through more hoops for less money and will be less eligible to receive that money, even if the money becomes available. For FY 2017, all municipalities participating will submit as part of their application a copy of the municipality's ADA self-evaluation survey. That's the Americans with Disabilities Act. And the ADA self-evaluation survey and transition plan.
I think Kevin has to do that anyway, though, doesn't he?
Correct. Now, the plan, I did a little bit of reading on it. It involves a great deal of work. It involves, at the very beginning, the establishment of a commission on disabilities in town, basically an MCAD commission. Mm. And the MCAD commission has specific formation requirements. It requires to have a certain number of people on it, and a certain number of those people have to be people that have disabilities, and so on and so forth. The easiest way around this is to basically create a statement of standing, which will suffice for this first CDBG grant round. A statement of standing basically is a statement that says, here's where we're at in relation to coming up with that transition plan, that self-evaluation survey. So I did prepare that statement based on a couple of different statements from a couple of different towns and based on where we are at. It doesn't commit the town to doing anything on any kind of timeline,
okay.
But it does commit the town to meeting certain benchmarks. I gave a draft version of it to Pam Parmakian from the Franklin Regional Housing Authority. Is that where she's from? Yes, Franklin Regional Housing Authority, and she did say that it would be, it would suffice as a first step.
Okay.
So is this something I can do every year?
Eventually.
The plan would be a document that would be kind of, to some extent, a policy document. It would provide a series of steps that the town would commit to commit towards. And again, plans run the gamut. Some of them have timelines, some of them have budgets, some of them have expectations, and so on and so forth. The plan is pretty encompassing or comprehensive. It would come into play when the town is doing sidewalk rebuilding. It would come into play when the town is spraying down lines for crosswalks, when the town is considering how a street is to be re-engineered and all of that. So that is a huge step. A plan would commit the town to financial obligations. I assumed that we were not ready to do that. So the statement of standing is the
Was the last time it was done, or was it ever?
I don't believe
never, it was never done.
Yeah. So a statement of standing is the lowest cost first step that the town can do that allows us to proceed forward with our CDBG funding application.
So would you have that for our next meeting, Doug?
You should have a copy of that draft.
You have the summary of self-evaluation mm-hmm. transition plan process. Is this what you're talking about?
No, it should be. There should be another letter immediately after it.
After.
There's a lot of information related to that.
That's for.
If you're at the FCOG, maybe I apologize. Maybe it's not there.
A letter from Pam.
So this isn't it right here?
That's the summary.
Because it's I'm supposed to sign it.
Okay.
So I think that's what you mean.
I may have neglected to include it.
To creation.
Because see, implementation. Back,
right, for a spot for you to sign.
Yeah. So if we vote this plan will be and I sign it, then that you can submit it.
Summary of the self-evaluation transition plan process should be on town letterhead.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, we could make a vote so that I could sign it when it's ready. Is that all right with you guys?
And then, so let me just back up a sec. So we're
sending a letter in saying that we're making a plan.
Mm-hmm. Basically. And when we make that plan, we can reach out to people in the community with disabilities that could be.
Well, what we need to do is we have to convene what we have to do is have a meeting where people are aware that we're going to have mm-hmm. a meeting about it mm-hmm. and invite people in
great.
To talk about it. So it okay. basically is a public hearing, yep. but it would be interactive mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. hopefully people will participate.
Yeah.
Broadly speaking, I've got it here, the statement I put together commits Deerfield to establishing an ADA advisory committee, mm-hmm. Which will be tasked with organizing, assuring the quality of, and presenting the completed self-evaluation. The committee would seek input from various town departments, Heads of town departments will be asked to participate in a survey of town facilities to see if town facilities meet our ADA obligations. The committee would include representatives from various town boards, and then that committee would create the mission statement, the development and drafting of the self-evaluation, and the transition plan, and other tasks.
Do we have to do this for this grant period?
We don't have to do all that work for the grant period. This letter will suffice.
Okay.
This statement of saying where we're at and where we want to go.
If we do this tonight, this goes to the Franklin Regional Housing Authority.
As part of their CDBG application, which will include the town of Deerfield. Yes.
So we need to do it. Yeah, we can work on the other.
Okay.
I'll be able to provide a final copy for you.
That's
correct. I made sure to not include a timeline.
All you're doing is saying, well,
we're going to do it.
Our next step will be able to do this.
Right.
And whatever you guys.
And if we get no grant money.
If you don't do anything, it's not.
Bruce, do you know more about that?
I just know one thing. If the town submits an application without the ADA self-evaluation transition plan, they will be reported to Mass Office on Disability.
Mm-hmm.
Mass Office on Disability will then deal with the town in its own right.
MCAD will provide assistance to the town in helping to establish a commission and to make sure the commission is properly organized. And
so are you? Is this a recommendation to do this or not do this, Bruce?
I don't know.
Oh, you don't want to?
If we don't do this, then we will be less likely to be approved for CDBG funding, less eligible for it. This is the broader picture that was illustrated by the other documents submitted by Pam sent to the board, is that CDBG changes in the way the funding is going to work is going to mean that Deerfield is going to be less eligible anyways due to its economic standing, and that there's going to be less money available, and that there will be more restrictions put on that money. So CDBG becomes less and less attractive as an option.
You're putting to what Bruce just said, you're putting your hands on the table waiting to see if they're going to get slapped.
Right.
And what Doug is saying is that
it may not be worth it.
Very little incentive
gain.
So what I was
saying.
Expose
yourself to that. So
all the while, we can still make our towns accessible for our handicapped.
I mean,
regardless of
we want to do the right thing.
We want to do the right thing for our community.
Right. But you want to do it on your.
That's right.
Not on somebody holding the switch to your.
And taking money away from things that have already been.
Right.
Yeah. Yep.
Bruce.
One other question. About a month and a half ago, there was a request to establish
a commission on disabilities. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
And it was forwarded to the Highway Department Superintendent. And there's been no discussion since.
Correct.
Right.
Correct.
Where we're headed with it.
Well, nobody's had time to do that. And part of that is my problem because I was on vacation for 2 weeks. So
Forming a commission or an advisory commission, an ADA commission for the town, is a pretty significant step. The authority of that commission is defined in state law. Mm-hmm. Instead of just by, you know, a bylaw that we might draft or create on our own. So by establishing that commission, you're jumping into a pool. You're jumping into a stream, and you've got to make sure you're careful as to where that stream is going to carry you.
Kevin hasn't had time to deal with it, and right. I haven't followed up on it.
Why is it Kevin's?
Because he's our ADA coordinator.
Just because
designated.
Or that's we designated the board
designated him at some point.
Okay.
Yeah. With his role as sort of director of facilities.
Our highway department, the head of the highway department has traditionally been the ADA coordinator because they're in charge of maintenance of buildings
and
the
access
streets
to buildings.
And so you get access on the streets and the sidewalks and the buildings and all that kind of stuff. So it's just he's taken the assignment because you have to have one.
I get it.
It's like an animal control officer. You have to have someone designated.
I am interested in making sure that all our buildings are ADA.
Oh, absolutely.
But, you know, and then we can get some buy-in from our community that may want to be involved, whether it's a full-fledged committee or not.
Yes, Bruce.
Well, The other question I have relative to that issue is, when we sent the letter from MassOps and Disability, or was it a generic letter stating, requesting communities to establish the commission?
We were actually sent a letter from Pam Parmaklian from the Franklin Regional Housing Authority. This is, her interest is mostly about the CDBG grant funding and the application that...
He's talking before.
Oh, you're talking previous? Oh, okay.
Previous letter that was sent to the town, was a general letter sent to all communities?
It was a letter sent to communities that don't already have an ADA commission.
So they're aware of it?
They're aware of it.
Asking the town to establish?
Correct. And it is the town's prerogative to do so or to not do so. So, yeah. What's that?
The town can be sued.
Yep.
How?
Because we're not meeting the requirements.
Of the ADA?
Yeah.
You're supposed to have a commission.
If there are cases where the ADA, the accessibility is not present, we could be sued.
Yes, you could.
Can we be sued for not having an ADA commission?
No, not at all.
Okay. It's my understanding that it's an optional thing that the town, yeah. You're absolutely right that if we have steps and that's the only way to get into the building, absolutely, we open ourselves up to liability. Sure.
So what do you want to do, guys? You want to wait on this for another 2 weeks? Talk to Kevin.
I'm going to talk to Kevin while I'm talking about Captain Latham. So I'll talk to him about that and see.
Yeah, okay.
How much you were dumping on his plate.
All right, let's table.
I know,
Douglas,
that's why I don't
table.
Want
that's what I'm concerned
yeah.
about, yeah. and maybe we need to appoint somebody else.
Well, I'll talk to him about it, see okay. what he thinks.
Yeah. Okay. I just don't want to bury
yeah.
him.
I know. It's a bad time of year.
Yes.
Okay. Other information, Doug, you have for us?
You have some other information in your packet. Draft minutes from the final meeting of the FRCOG Pipeline Committee, along with a letter sent by that committee to federal legislators, actually was sent by the COG itself, recommending improvements to the FERC application review process and to FERC itself. That concludes the work of that committee, which adjourned without day after that meeting.
Okay.
I wanted to make sure that you're aware. I don't know if I put any information in the packet, but many people have noticed the blue ribbons in front of Town Hall. These are part of a campaign by wives and family of state police officers. It's a campaign to place blue ribbons in front of municipal buildings, on public facilities, and in adjacent to police departments to raise public awareness of the work and sacrifice done by local and state police. I just want to make sure folks were aware of it. Mm-hmm. It wasn't some strange blue ribbon vandal or anything like that. The group contacted the chief, and he gave permission to place the ribbons.
But I watched some on town meeting, and they were asking permission of the Sunderland Select Board.
Correct.
To grant permission.
Correct.
Not the chief.
And they denied it. Correct.
And they denied it.
Correct.
Because people were gonna
the request came to the chief, and he granted it.
No, I was just wondering why one went to the chief and one didn't go to the select board.
Actually, the request originally came to the Sunderland head of the DPW. Who then forwarded it to the select board, which then said, yeah, we choose not to.
Why did they choose not to?
I don't know.
Anybody know why?
Just that they said there's enough ribbons around town and that people are going to put them up no matter what. So they didn't seem, if my understanding of that meeting was
sure.
They didn't seem to me the need to approve it because people were going to do it on their own.
Well, my stance was we didn't want to cause a lot of commotion, but it was perfectly okay to do this because, you know,
we
do support police. I mean,
right.
But
yes, that was their,
we were just worried that, you know, I didn't want a lot of discussion on it because, you know, I didn't want it to seem like we were supporting police versus something not supporting somebody
right.
else.
Mm.
But in general, we support the police, so that's
sure.
why part of the ribbons just showed up. Because I didn't want a huge public discussion. Yeah, but obviously
okay.
we support our police, especially our local police, and so you know, in my mind, it was perfectly okay. So
okay,
I don't know.
In your agenda, there's some upcoming dates. I wanted to outline a couple of them. There is a planning board meeting on Monday. This is in regard to a subdivision. One of the topics will be a subdivision preliminary plan that's been submitted. I would strongly urge you to attend to be informed.
I'll be there anyway.
What time?
I figure you would be there, yeah. That meeting starts at 7 p.m. There's a number of things on the planning board's agenda. It will likely be a longer meeting.
Okay.
There's no opportunity for public discussion about it or public input, but it is important to understand where the planning board is coming from in relation to that. Mm-hmm. So there's that. On September 14th, 1 week from today, there will be a presentation by Terry Williams here at Town Hall. The Finance Committee, the CIPC, and the Select Board are strongly urged to attend. Terry's going to be providing information in regard to financial and budgeting calendars, as well as the roles of those three committees in developing the town's budget.
That's at 4:30?
That's at 4 p.m. on the
4 p.m.
Doug, could you just send out a reminder to all the committees that he's coming?
I already have, but I will do that again as we get closer.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
I haven't gotten that?
I just want
to
make...
Do I have your email address? Okay.
Okay. Is that 4 or 4:30?
4 o'clock.
4 o'clock. I had it at 4:30, but... Yep. Okay.
We've... about 6 weeks ago, we scheduled this, and I will be sending reminders to everybody about it. Terry Williams is, of course, our representative from the Division of Local Services, the state DOR, and he's been working with the town for several years.
14, okay.
Yeah. I had 4:30 as well, so I just wanted to make sure people were aware it was 4 o'clock.
Yep.
So it's next, Bruce, it's next Wednesday at 4 o'clock.
Is there any handouts that would be available prior to the meeting?
We've received none as of yet. I will inquire tomorrow with Brenda.
That's a good point. Thank you.
Yeah.
The whole idea is to get some advice from him, and it doesn't necessarily mean that we have to take his advice, but I think it would be very helpful to get a general overview. He's a really good guy. The small town.
That's a meeting on September 15th, the next day. It's during the day. It's a quarterly meeting of the Small Town Administrators of Massachusetts, which is essentially a trade group. There will be town administrators, executive assistants, town coordinators from throughout Western Mass, and actually Eastern Mass. They're from throughout the state. They'll be coming here to hold a lunch-type meeting.
Good.
No attendance is necessary. It's basically information and exchange. And then, of course, the next sewer study committee is posted for 6 p.m. on September 22nd.
Okay. And we just set a CPA meeting for 5:30 on the 21st.
Okay.
I'm not CPA.
CIPC.
CP.
Yeah. 5 p.m.
It's Capital Planning Improvement Committee. Yes, but I was getting my acronyms mixed up. I was thinking CPA. It's just Capital Improvement.
And I know you've got some public comment. You're opening the floor to public comment next,
yes.
But I will just state that I will be requesting an executive session for deliberation of sale or transfer of real estate.
Okay.
I wanted to hit on something real quick, too.
Sure.
I was made aware that there's a real mess at Stillwater Bridge.
Yes.
We have a lot of people coming into town and dumping tons of trash. Like, there's bags and bags and bags that need to be filled. So I'm hoping to reach out and get people together to maybe do a cleanup on a weekend or something like that to try and clean that area. I'd love to be able to figure out if we could do signs, some way to kind of stop the amount of trash that's getting, you know, if we have a high rain, all that's going right in the river. We just don't need it in our town. It's too beautiful a place to be completely trashed like that. And the pictures I saw online this week were just really shocking. So I wanted to find
out. Are there trash barrels there?
There are not. And I don't know if that's a policy that we have on.
The what?
There were, but I think that when the state put up those guardrails, they did away with all those trash barrels. And a lot of that trash is, if you've ever been on the river, is the people coming down or the people on the river, on the banks.
Dumping.
Just leave their stuff.
Yeah.
And nobody picks up after them.
Yep. It's horrendous. Okay. Yeah. And
Actually, it's not as bad as it has been in years past.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, this was, we saw some photos this week that were just really bad.
It's gross to have the dirty diapers and all that kind of stuff.
Funny you should mention it, because on our website, where we've been advertising the 20th annual Source to See cleanup, which is coming up on September 23rd and 24th. This happens up and down the Connecticut River and tributaries to the Connecticut River. And it's supported by the Connecticut River Watershed Council. Locally, there are opportunities for people to get involved. There's also links off of our website for people to access information. There's a video that you can take a look at that allows you to learn a little bit more about it. And we strongly urge folks to get involved. I believe it's, is it Jay Stryker who's coordinated that in the past? And he's doing so again this year?
Well, it's, and maybe you can just make a phone call tomorrow to Andy Fisk or Andrea Donlin up at the Connecticut River Watershed and put in a specific site request.
Yep, absolutely. We can
bridge.
Do that.
Yeah.
Yep.
The only thing I can think of, sometimes the private schools, both Deerfield Academy and Eagle Brook, have, you know, like community days, and some of their kids will do cleanup. It's just that
do we not want to go
like
through the expense
huge
of our putting trash?
No, because we don't want to have the responsibility of dumping trash. And the problem is, by putting trash cans there, then it allows people to dump on a regular basis.
I see.
And we don't
want anybody.
You get people dumping their household trash in the
we
can
don't want
instead
dumping.
Of bringing it
yes.
to
I get
the
that.
Station.
Yes.
I used to work for the DCI.
Oh, yes.
Take care of the Stillwater area.
Thank you.
And in the campgrounds, again, you got to get lug it in, lug it out policy. Because if you put trash cans around, people are going to bring all their
They can clean out their cars. They're going to do everything.
Can we get some signs that, you know, just remind people on the way in, way out, just, you know, take it in, take it out?
I wonder. I have to talk to Kevin, too, but is there a fine in town? Is there a zoning?
There is a littering.
There's got to be littering.
There is a littering.
Yeah, there is littering.
You got to catch people in the end.
You know, what we can do is we can
tree stand.
We're participating in the FERCOG sign thing. So maybe we can get Kevin to get some signs made.
I would just love
at relatively cheap.
Remind people that, you know, like take
littering.
It in, take it out. I just really,
and then
such a beautiful place.
Maybe we can get someone to volunteer to, if that doesn't work, then we can maybe put some cameras out or something.
That's what I was thinking. You would do a tree stand
John,
camera. Hey, you're on camera. You want to drop it? They do, and that's what I've heard, that their police sit there. Yeah.
You get their vehicle and their license.
We got a plate,
Bruce.
Speaking of Stillwater area, I know the town has put up all those orange trash barrels, whatever you want to call them, big cones, big barrels and everything, because of the truck going over, coming up out of the Stillwater area.
That's DCR property, and what has happened is we had declared that it was an emergency, you know, because the guy rolled over. So DCR is going to put up the gate, and what we're going to do is shore up that area, because what's happening, is the road is caving in, and access, continued access down there, the whole area, the riparian buffer is totally trashed.
But so, the thing is, like, we kayak, and there's no road to go down anymore to kayak. Can you lose your kayaks down?
No, but there will be a gate for emergency access.
But
so
that
there,
doesn't help me, is what I'm saying.
No.
There's no going to be any access to walk down. You have to walk down the bank that's loaded with poison ivy.
I think the purpose of repairing that ramp is to provide emergency access.
It's to provide
if there's
going to
be public
access
to the river across that property, that's up to DCR.
DCR owns the property, you know, where the Cheapside Bridge is, between that and that house. They were supposed to put in a handicap access, access to the river, because everything else is natural, and you get so much traffic foot traffic and vehicle traffic, the riparian buffers are totally trashed. And so they're not acting as riparian buffers when we have flooding events. They're completely already eroded. And it's undermining our road, and our road is caving in, and it will be a several hundred thousand dollar fix if we have a major rain event. So what we're using this event to do is to provide a ramp for emergency access and to shore up our road and repair our road so it will not continue to be undermined. So unfortunately, we're meeting the needs of, you know, immediate needs of the town and first responders, but we are not addressing access to the river. And we just can't afford to, actually. Bruce.
Just to follow up to the question whether we had any bylaw relative to dumping.
Mm.
We do. It's under town bylaws, Division 3, Section 219, garbage and waste. And there's 219-3 describes unlawful dumping, which occurs several areas in the community, not just Stillwater.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a violation and penalty. It's punishable by the imposition of a penalty not to exceed the amount of $20.
Mm.
I think it needs to be looked at.
I think that would be another. Yes, because we had a lot of problems off of Sand Gully for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Sand Gully was a dumping ground for several years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But the thing is, too, you think somebody, when they brought their Christmas tree to the dump, and they notice it's still not on the back of their truck or in their truck, that they wouldn't go back to try to find it, and they just leave it?
Yeah.
That's the sad thing. You know,
I know.
No one takes responsibility for that. So how are you going to enforce that?
Mm.
I feel guilty about throwing an apple core out the window.
Yeah.
I know.
I'm
feeding raccoons.
Yeah, that's what I thought, yeah.
Mark.
Our children.
Back to the original conversation.
Yes.
If you're willing to take that section.
Yeah.
And advertise that, you know.
Get a group of kids.
You need the contact for you or whatever, and we'll do the see the cleanup for that section.
Yeah.
Usually what they do is they get certain groups to go out of the plains, and river roads been done by
the Ava Gibbs.
Oh yeah, Ava Gibbs. Yeah.
There's another one.
That's true. Yep.
And we'll take that one if the town will agree to at least take the trash to the dump.
Mm.
I think Kevin has with the
river. He has always cleaner. Has, but just to give him the support that he not
absolutely.
Put his neck
in regard to the source to see cleanup, the request has been made of the town as to whether or not the town would accept the trash collected during that project. I forwarded the request to Kevin for his advisement. You could also make that decision.
Yes,
as well.
Traditionally we have always done that, and if that is all right for you.
Absolutely.
Okay. Would agree to do that.
Well, I'd help you with
I would love that
section,
Mark.
And you know,
I'll be in touch.
They can, you know, contact you or contact me or.
Yep, that'd be great.
Kevin or somebody to coordinating it, and that day will go down.
Great.
Just completely clean it up.
Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you so much for the help.
The other day, somebody removed the barricades and drove down.
I know. Well,
perfect.
Believe it or not, it's been.
Have the police go by there and check on that.
Well, believe it or not, Sunday is 30 days. You know, we had this emergency order for 30 days. So, COCOTS have got to get in, and Kevin's got to get in. I think tomorrow.
He is doing that work and completing that
tomorrow and Friday. So
yep.
It will be done by the 30-day cutoff. So, the barrels will be gone, and the gate will be up. Hopefully.
That'd be great.
So. We will have public, I mean, I'm sorry about the public access.
The gate usually doesn't stop people
I know.
From walking in. It just stops from driving.
The vehicle.
It's just, yeah. It's just an inconvenience when you're trying to get in there with a kayak.
Mm.
Yeah.
It's, you know,
I know. You know what, Kathy? Kathy, we'll send another letter to DCR and ask them to encourage them to, I know the environmental
just, you know,
bond project.
Just so you can access it. You know.
Well, the environmental bond bill, you know, has been money's been released. So we'll just send a letter Doug, send a letter to DCR, you know, asking them to pursue the development of that ADA access. Because one of the reasons we wanted that is so that some of the pressure would be off Stillwater, that we wouldn't have as many people coming.
But the Cheapside area is not a good area.
I know, but they're supposed to put in parking, there's room for parking and all kinds of stuff, so, I mean, it would be good. The way they envisioned it, and, but they just, you know, there was no money, and, you know, this was like 2008, 2009, so, because of the economy, nobody pursued it, but the new environmental bond was just been released, the money, this July 1st, so we'll see if we can get it done in the next couple of years. We'll send another letter.
Okay.
Is there any other public comment?
Yes, I have one question. I know at the last meeting, I know you weren't here, Carolyn, but you heard about requested the Ag Committee somebody come in, or?
We were hoping to have an Ag Committee meeting, yeah.
No, that's not what my question was. At the last meeting, you weren't here, they had requested the two selectmen, Trevor and Kip, requested that somebody from the Ag Committee come in and speak to the selectmen about the...
Well, unfortunately, it's right in the middle of harvest time, so...
Carolyn, you're not telling me anything I know, but Ben was here from the Ag. People were here, and people didn't know about it.
The request went out via email to the chair of the Agricultural Commission, as well as the chair of the Open Space Committee, to set up a time where they could provide a joint meeting with the select board. There's been no response from either chair at this point.
And I'll pursue it, because it was my request, that I felt that once harvest season was done, that we need to be talking about this next year coming up and the use of propane.
Yeah, I was just wondering why, did you get no response? I was just wondering why.
Well, they haven't had a meeting, and they don't have a chair. We forwarded it to Steve Taylor, who was the last chair, but Doug has said that he does not want to be chair again, so. We know who is on the...
They just, you know, it was just never followed through, or what the concept, what the results were of that.
Well, it's something we're going to work on over the winter, before spring planting. So it might have some, you know, their planting plans, if they were going to plant next door to someone's house, and they were going to have to use the gun, then maybe they would plant somewhere else.
Or plant somewhere else.
Yeah, I mean, it might affect...
It's not that easy.
I know, but it...
Not that easy.
I agree, I know.
Community, and there's, you know, and this is really, I don't ever remember the gun being used.
I haven't either. So I, so that's why...
It all depends on where the sweet corn is, all depends on your growing season.
Timing, all that.
All depends on a bunch of different factors, so there's no guarantee the farmer can give to say that that's not going to happen.
No, but if we could just get some understanding why it's being used now, and does it need to be that loud? Does it need to be that often? Does it need to be all night long? I mean, it was tough.
Oh, I know. I was right.
Yeah.
It was on our heels.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I did reach out to other towns through the town administrator support network, which turns out to be more like a counseling group as anything. and there are some towns that have put in place sound restrictions on agricultural use. And if you'd like, I can pursue those a little bit more and find out what is there. But I was kind of waiting to hope to see if the Agricultural Committee could meet and actually engage in a conversation.
I would rather have the conversation
At that level.
Yes.
Fair enough.
I mean, local level first.
So what I can do is, again, follow up with all of the members of that committee and say, there's an issue that really needs to come before the Ag Committee.
Yes.
Please set up a time
to
meet.
That'd be great.
We have to vote to go into executive session. Is there any other comments? Yes.
I was just like to say, just the board, I'm very distraught at your decision and your suggestion from Richard that everything is okay on Mr. Gilmore's property.
We said we are pursuing, if you, let me read, did you want me to reread the statement? It's his recommendation not to follow up for another 30 days, but let me just read it. But there isn't any you can't, basically, you can't regulate neat and tidiness.
Tidiness, that's not the issue. It's not a messy neighbor anymore. It's a deplorable condition on Mr. Gilmore's property where Matthew lives, is residing. It's not an issue with a bylaw about a messy neighbor. He's got a dump site there.
Well,
solid waste dump site and burial site, and he had a bunch of debris pile up there in the backyard that needs to be removed. You know, that's going to invite, who knows, rat infestation, whatever, over there.
Well,
it needs to be resolved. This committee needs to resolve this issue. This town needs to resolve this issue and make it right for all the neighbors. It seems like Martin's son has all the rights in the world in this town, something. It's ethically and morally wrong what's happened to that property. He's literally destroyed the property. It used to be a pristine little field there, nice cottage. And look what's happened to it. And nobody's done anything since the onset, almost, oh, it's been 3 years now.
That's absolutely not true. We've had DEP to the site. We ourselves have been to the site.
I understand.
Richard Kalaszewski has been there multiple times. He's monitoring.
I talked to Henry. I haven't talked to Trevor. I don't like to bother people at home at night. I talked to Richard several times.
Well,
something needs to happen here in this town. It's not right.
Well, there's no violations at this point.
No violations.
No violations of our zoning.
I have to.
No bylaw against a messy neighbor. This is way beyond a messy neighbor, for sure. And if there's no bylaws, you gotta make a bylaw. This can't happen. We've had other people from other towns come to us and say, "What the heck is going on in your town? This would never happen in our town." This is getting disappointing. Very disappointing.
We are. We're monitoring it, and that's the most we can do at this point.
I'd just like to say, I understand your frustration. We have seen that property just go extremely downhill. It looks a mess. There's more and more piles of dirt piling up there. I don't know legally what right we have if there's not a zoning violation. The enforcement of that property is under our zoning board. Dick Kalaszewski is in charge of enforcing the zoning bylaws there. I agree. I think it's a dump. I just really wish it would get, if it needs to be leveled out, get a bulldozer and level it out. I don't know why piles of dump and dirt and stumps and everything else are there.
Get some equipment out of there, but fine, get some excavators in there.
I agree, and I don't know if it's cost.
There's no violation. When dirt piles and stump piles is not a violation.
There's activity going on there daily. We can hear banging, grinding, drilling, whatever. There's something going on there which you guys denied a business permit for him.
Mm-hmm.
He's doing something there daily, so there's no peace and quiet during the day even.
Yeah.
We live right across.
Bruce, did you have?
Sorry,
you have a question?
I'd just like to back up what he's saying, but there are zoning regulations that you should look at. Specifically, two. One is 3723. It discusses removal of vegetation and cleared in areas cannot be filled more than 6 inches, and no stripped area. Which are allowed by special permit, shall remain under winter without a temporary cover and planting material. And there's also 2242 general landscaping requirements, specifically 3316, which is, says to preserve and improve the visual environmental character of the town of Deerfield, as generally viewed from residential or publicly accessed locations. And it discusses in 3316, it says to offer property owners protection against delimitation of property values due to a non-residential, adjacent non-residential use. Mm. And I believe that's it, what's occurring.
None of that is occurring. The stuff that's on the property is to be used by the property. There's a lot of money expended to get it to where it is at this point in time. And basically, the board has made it clear that there will be no business allowed on that, which is what my son envisioned, having a small business come there, and so he's going to have to move out. And spending a lot of money on something where he's got to move. He already has spent a lot of money to get to where it is right now. And I'm really sorry that, you know, your opinion of what is pretty is the only opinion you can have. So,
yes. I'm not going to have a discussion with a resident, but under the use schedule, under RA, a motor vehicle repair shop is not allowed. Junkyard or automobile graveyard is not allowed.
That's right.
And a repair shop is not allowed.
That's right.
And I think if you look at some of the materials that sit on that site and what they contain, you might determine that there are these types of operations happening on that site.
Dick has been there on a regular basis, and he goes by there almost daily, and the vehicles are registered. And
what about the truck body, the back of the truck that's sitting out back empty?
Trailers.
If you look at the dumping bylaw, it's very specific that you can't do what he's doing. And I have another question. When I use the town's website, and click on a name of an official in town, that pops up an email address. I can send an email. Is that part of the website working? And if I was to email an official a document, would they receive it?
They should.
Okay. I wouldn't know because there's no way of getting an acceptance.
I mean, a notice that it came through.
Was received.
I've gotten several emails through the town email so far, but not anything attached so far. But
I can speak for our office. We've also gotten several emails, feedback from the website. I'm pretty sure that Richard has as well. So providing feedback to departments, to department heads, to various board and committee members, that should be working just fine.
It's just the issue. We don't know. I mean, typically, if you email, you can request a return receipt or acceptance.
Sure. Yep.
And
yep.
That might be a way of improving.
I can take a look at the website to see if we can add that. I'll talk to the developer.
We are continuing to monitor it. And that, you know, but that's all I can commit at this time.
I would like to not remind the board, but through you to the viewers, that the zoning enforcement officer is the person who's empowered by Mass General Law to address violations of zoning. The zoning enforcement officer in Deerfield has been advised of three different methods that he can use to enforce zoning, including legal action, both in the at the land court level as well as in the criminal courts. Dick is very aware of his options, and he's pursuing options as he sees fit. I think it's appropriate.
We'll continue to monitor. Okay. Thank you. Well, I make a motion
have similar. My complaint is relative to what these people are saying.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. I own property on 7th Thayer Street. If you're familiar with where Thayer Street is,
yes.
I live next door to the former Lipinski funeral home.
Yep.
I came in, and it's in a dilapidated condition. I came in about 3 weeks ago, and the clerk will verify that, to make an appointment to see the selectman. The secretary says, well, the building inspector is in now. Why don't you go see him? So I went and saw the building inspector. He was in his office with his secretary and two other individuals, right? I told him the situation and so forth, and he says, I'll look at it, and he says, I'll send the letter in, or I'll do something about it. Mm-hmm. I waited 2 weeks, right? And over 2 weeks, I came in, and I says, did you contact the owner of the building and say, yeah. I says, could I see a copy of the letter? He says, well, I didn't just send a letter. He said, I called on the phone. I said, who'd you talk to? What position? What was his position in the business or whoever owns it? Well, he didn't say. I said, well, how did you get his number? He said, well, go see the assessor. She knows who the property belongs to. Okay.
Mm-hmm. I know he made a site visit, sir.
Okay. And so then he tells me, I said, well, okay, fine. I'll go. The selectmen are your boss. I'll go to the selectman's office and make an appointment. I went. I talked to the clerk. I made an appointment, and came here. While I was talking to the clerk, he came, started barging into the office. Next time you want a complaint, you sign it in a letter. You send it in a letter. I said, well, why didn't you send a letter to the company when you complained to the individual who owns the building? Turned around and walked out. In fact, no, he didn't turn around. I said, look, I'm talking with this gentleman here. Would you please leave us alone? And he turned around and walked away. Hmm. Now, I have pictures of the house. Oh, I asked him, I said, did you go down and see the house? He says, yes, I did. I said, what did you see? He couldn't tell me. No,
well,
I have pictures here. If the board were willing to look at
sure.
it and see.
I would love to.
Yep, it's fine.
What address is this?
Okay, these are.
And I apologize. Before you start, can I, just for the record, can I get your name?
Ralph Olszewski.
Ralph Olszewski, thank
That's
you.
Olszewski.
Thank you.
This is my home, not my home, but my apartment that I rent out.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
That's still it. Whoop. That's one of my backyard and so
okay.
forth.
Mm-hmm.
That's the front of the house.
Mm-hmm.
Now this is Lipinski Funeral. That used to be the funeral home there, right?
Okay.
No, I'm not too adept.
Oh, touch it once. There we go.
Okay. Now this is the third blue carpet that was plastic that was put on this thing.
Wow.
Now where did all that plastic go? It's all over the neighborhood.
Deteriorating.
Okay. Now, which way did I turn
yep.
it down?
Whoop. You can touch that again. Yep.
Right here.
And then just okay. slide over again.
Okay. All right.
And
that's
one more.
That's a pile of dirt that's been there. Now, this
stone.
Situation has been for the last 15 years.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well.
There's the side of the house.
Those are new windows.
There's part of the house there. This is a better view of the sand pile mm-hmm. and in a garage. It's all boarded
but
up, so forth.
Is it? But I think Dick has found it's not abandoned. Someone does own it, because
he does.
You know, the bank. He assumed that the bank had foreclosed on it, and if the bank had foreclosed on it, then we could go in as the town and say it was a nuisance. But the persons still own it. The bank did not foreclose
on
it.
Who owns it? I don't know who owns it.
Well, Dick didn't tell me who owned it, but the person had apparently is
okay.
current on
now
all their mortgage payments.
And no, here's the growth. Where do I get it? Yeah, this is the growth on. No, this is all within 10 feet of my house. Okay.
But
if there's a fire, what chances? Now my tenants are all elderly. I have an upstairs apartment, a downstairs apartment.
I understand.
The last tenant was 92 years old. If there was a fire, how could she get out in a hurry?
No, I agree, but sir.
Look at it.
Well, right? Yeah, it is overgrown.
Look at that. That's part of the chimney for the heating of the funeral home. You see that, Henry?
Yeah.
And there's, right?
But what you're asking us to do is to, I mean, we can't enforce someone to cut down bushes.
Well, this board, not this board of selectmen, but the board of selectmen at the time did enforce it. How about the Mike River property? They set a precedent there, right? They took and demolished his house without even, took it by eminent domain and did nothing with it. They set the precedent.
Well,
all I'm asking is to contact the owners and say if they don't do them, the town will do it at their expense. Now, as far as I know, I think a bank owns it, so the money shouldn't be a problem. Pardon?
Is that legal?
I don't know.
Right. So we'd first have to get a ruling on whether we could
Dick told me that they are current on their payments.
To the tax?
To the bank.
To the bank and to
the
our
The bank is not,
taxes.
Did not foreclose on it.
There may be some options available to the town, but they are very, very deeply in the legal weeds, and I would recommend getting legal counsel's advice. I certainly sympathize with the situation,
sure,
but the town has to be careful at how it proceeds in order to not waste either legal capital or actual capital.
I mean, I understand what you're talking about. The brush has grown up along your property line, right. And I agree, it's an eyesore. But if we start cutting the brush along that property line, I mean, there are people that, you know, everywhere across town that would want to brush to be.
No, that's not a very good explanation, ma'am.
Well,
right? Just because everybody says, oh, you cut my brush too? Would you cut my brush?
I don't know. We'll look into it.
A fire hazard. There's environments there and everything.
Well,
right?
we'll look into it.
The condition of it.
Yes. Mm-hmm. If you can forward the pictures to Doug, and then we'll look into it, okay?
I don't know how to do it, Joe.
If you could just stop by town office tomorrow.
With this?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay.
And then I'll help you out.
Oh, yeah. Okay, fine. Sure.
And then we'll get the pictures and we'll look into it, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I understand your distress, right. And
yeah,
so we can look into it.
Thank you for your concern.
Yeah.
Okay. Are we ready to go into the executive? Is there anyone else that would like a comment? Okay.
Any other meeting?
Can we go into executive session?
Yes. And make a motion to go into executive session.
For the deliberation of sale and transfer of real estate?
For the deliberation and sale of transfer of real estate. Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Carolyn Knapp. Oh, second. I second that.
Thank you.
Now
if there's no further questions, aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Carolyn Knapp.
Aye, Henrik Moser.